Our last presenter for our general session this afternoon is Dr. Sara Rosenthal. She received all of her academic training at the University of Toronto and her doctorate in bioethics from the University of Toronto's Joint Center for Bioethics. She is a professor of bioethics and director of the program for bioethics at the University of Kentucky, including the departments of internal medicine, pediatrics, and behavioral science. She is chair of UK Hospitals Ethics Committee and directs the Clinical Ethics Consult Service. She is also on faculty at the Center for Clinical and Translational Science at UK and directs the Research Ethics Consultation Service, also known as Benchside Ethics Consults. Dr. Rosenthal's research interests focus on endocrine ethics, reproductive ethics, and clinical ethics education, including her novel multimedia work on the topic of moral distress. Please welcome Dr. Rosenthal.
Well, thank you very much, and it's a pleasure to be here. Can everybody hear me? Okay. So what I wanted to just explain is you're going to get a little bit of what I call a tour talk. So this is really a tour of a range of issues. I'm going to cover a lot of issues today. Each one of these could individually make up, you know, an hour or even a two-hour talk. But I just wanted to show you the range of issues that are going on in this very complex clinical context. So we're going to talk about the application of clinical ethics principles to oncology. So it's not as though oncology doesn't have its own set of clinical ethics principles, but it's important to understand how they apply. We'll be focusing more on informed consent, capacity issues, and advanced directives. I'll cover a little bit of some of the types of ethical dilemmas that everybody probably deals with on a daily basis, and we'll also talk about moral distress and what's known as pathological grieving. So, clinical ethics principles in oncology, if we divide them into sort of our four P's, you've probably heard of the principle of autonomy more often than the principle of respect for persons. The principle of respect for persons is really a dual obligation to both protect autonomous patients' wishes, but also to honor autonomous patients' wishes and preferences, but to protect those who are not autonomous. So we prefer to actually deal with the principle of respect for persons. And this is sort of where, under this principle, houses informed consent and truth-telling and the decision-making capacity issues, advanced directives, all the surrogacy issues, and the end-of-life decisions. The principle of beneficence is really, I sometimes refer to the principle of beneficence as the doctors or the healthcare providers' dilemmas, all the treatment planning, when do you introduce innovative therapies, dealing with having these difficult discussions, when to introduce palliative care or decide that you want to withdraw aggressive treatment. So that's sort of all within the principle of beneficence. And that's a dual principle that obligates you to maximize benefit but minimize harm. The principle of non-maleficence is a little bit different in that it's a specific obligation not to do intentional harm, so something that is sort of knowingly harmful or doesn't have any end benefit. So it's often hard in cancer therapy. We give chemotherapy, which can be harmful, but we're doing it with an intent to benefit. So that would be the difference. Non-maleficence is really where, you know, that sort of issues of frank misconduct and neglect and, you know, all kinds of things that we may know are harmful. But it also looks at sort of the harms that are, a lot of the psychosocial harms where we're sort of balancing, and that could be dealing with, you know, screening and false positives. So that's sort of where, why guidelines for mammography keep changing, because we know that there are harms associated with, you know, if you go for a mammogram every year and you're under 50, it's now sort of been shown that it doesn't necessarily lead to any improved outcomes, but it may also have, you know, the anxiety that women go through with a lot of these false positives and biopsies and that sort of thing. So that's sort of where we balance that. I'm not going to spend time talking about the duty to warn of genetic risks, but that's a very big part of prevention of harms, in that, you know, you have someone who may have an autosomal dominant mutation, they have at-risk relatives, but they refuse to disclose. And they tell you, don't tell anybody, thinking that it should be kept confidential, but you may feel as though you have a duty to warn at-risk third parties, and in fact the law tells you that you do, but I won't focus too much on that. And also issues with, patients may ask you about death with dignity laws. The Brittany Maynard case that was in the news a few months ago, of a young lady who was about 29. She had a severe inoperable advanced brain tumor, set up and moved to Oregon, set up residency. Many healthcare providers may be very uncomfortable participating in these kinds of requests, but those are also a part of whether or not you're doing harm or good. And the principle of justice is something that Kentucky deals with all the time. This is all the health disparities, the Kentucky uglies, the access to screening, access to genetic counseling. We find, for example, a lot of people when there are at-risk relatives who could benefit from some sort of prophylactic screening, they don't go often because they just don't have it covered. They don't have access to it. Who should be enrolled in a clinical trial? Who should have access? And I will spend a little bit of time talking about the economics of very expensive therapies. So the principle of respect for persons, as I mentioned, is the dual obligation to, you know, again, respect autonomous patients' wishes and protect non-autonomous patients. And it was crafted as a guiding ethical principle in the Belmont Report, and it also deals with vulnerable populations. So we like to use, clinical ethicists prefer to use this principle, because really it establishes when a patient is autonomous, and sometimes that's the biggest question, is do they have capacity? So we care about it because it's necessary for informed consent. It certainly helps you to guide care according to patient preferences, but that's the biggest question, is your patient autonomous? So let me just review. Informed consent sort of has two histories. It has a legal history and a moral history. So the legal doctrine of informed consent actually goes as far back as over 100 years ago now, the very first case of Schlondorf versus the Society of New York Hospital. Mary Schlondorf had she had a uterine tumor. She had requested that no matter what they find in the surgery, to, you know, absolutely do not give her a hysterectomy. They went ahead and did it anyway without her consent, and she sued back in 1914. Several of these cases, Wilkinson v. Vesey was actually a case about radiation therapy in which the patient was not given adequate information about some of the side effects, and this is where we get the term material risks that actually legally must be disclosed to patients. Canterbury v. Spence was another surgery case in which the courts established informed consent as a basic social policy. And Cobbs versus Grant was another case where it establishes the reasonable person standard. So when you're trying to figure out how much do I tell a patient, we're often left with, well, what would a reasonable person want to know in this circumstance? These are some later cases, and the first one, Bernard v. Char in 1995, established what we call the modified objective standard. So let's say you're an opera singer, and you need to have, and you have a head and neck cancer, and you need to have, you need to have work done. It's important to know whether this is going to affect your vocal cords, because that is your profession. So it has to do with, you know, do you have a certain profession where some of your cancer therapy is going to be, it's going to make a difference. If you're Angelina Jolie, it probably makes a big difference to understand how prophylactic therapy is going to, prophylactic surgery is going to affect you, because she's in the business of being a, you know, a celebrity, and sort of being attractive is part of her profession. So These are some of the more recent cases. The moral history of informed consent is complex, and so you have the it kind of is based on the history of research ethics, but this all forms what we do in a clinical context, and certainly for those of you who are doing clinical research would know a lot about this. So these are the 10. The Nuremberg Code was an American-authored document in response to the Nazi war atrocities, and this was actually established during the Nuremberg trials. So people think that it's sort of common for a number of people to think that because it was developed in 1947 that somehow we no longer have to follow this. It's old and outdated. This is actually still a code that we have to follow. The Declaration of Helsinki largely echoes Nuremberg, and this was the World Medical Association guidelines for research. It was first introduced in 1964. What's important about Helsinki is that this document called for the establishment of institutional review boards. In Europe, it's known as an ethical review board, as well as in Canada, but an ERB or an IRB is now part of what you have to do for research. Not all countries follow the Declaration of Helsinki or have codified research. Japan, for example, does not follow this. But it's been periodically revised, and the latest revision was in 2008. It's about to be revised again, and a new one should be coming out sometime in 2015. This is the Henry Beecher paper that I made reference to. This is a famous whistleblowing paper from 1966. And Henry Beecher was an anesthesiologist at Harvard who began to get very cranky that he was noticing articles and studies that were published throughout the 40s and 50s and 60s, early 60s, that he felt were actually not following the Nuremberg Code. And he started to make a collection. He originally wanted to expose about 50 studies that were in violation of the Nuremberg Code, but because of space restrictions, he had to cut it down to 22. The most infamous trial for this audience is probably the Brooklyn Jewish Chronic Disease Hospital, their live cancer cell study. This is a study in which they actually injected HeLa cells into elderly patients without consent to sort of see what would happen. Would they grow cancer from these cells? They didn't really have a clear purpose in doing this. The Willowbrook study, which many of you may have heard of, was a hepatitis study in which the Hep A virus is actually given to mentally disabled patients. And Beecher sort of calls for the Nuremberg Code to apply to U.S. clinical research. At the time, the prevailing view was that Nuremberg Code doesn't apply to American doctors because we're not Nazis, we're not committing atrocities. So that was sort of the viewpoint that that's just for them. We don't have to follow this. We're good people. We don't do any of these bad things. This is the infamous Tuskegee syphilis trial in which 400 black males, African-American black males, were followed but not treated for syphilis. It's important to note that when the trial first started, penicillin actually wasn't invented yet and was not a treatment, but that the trial had continued far beyond when penicillin had become the standard of care. So it was the withholding of the standard of care and the fact that it was an observational trial. All of these, the Beecher paper in particular, was a great influence on the Belmont Report, which came out in 1979. This was the formation of the National Commission for the Protection of Human Subjects, of Biomedical and Behavioral Research, which formed in 1975. And this is the report. And one of the commissioners was a philosopher. The term bioethicist, frankly, I don't think it really existed at this point, but one of the famous textbooks, the Beecham and Childress textbook of bioethical principles, Tom Beecham was actually on this committee, and so he was in the process already of forming the four principles and respect for persons. So they came out with the principle of respect for persons. They came out with beneficence and justice, and respect for persons was really dealing with subject with informed consent issues. They also had the beneficence was really dealing with does the study offer some benefit, and justice was really dealing with access and who should be enrolled in studies so that you're not, so that the burdens and benefits of research are evenly distributed amongst the population. You don't have one population you experiment on and one population you save just for the clinical trials and the special access. So it's that sort of thing. Title 45, which is the Code of Federal Regulations, was introduced in 1981, and that's what made all of these ethical guidelines federal law. So it's actually, we must by law now follow codified ethical guidelines, and the common rule basically combines Nuremberg, Helsinki, and Belmont, and it defines the minimum requirements for ethical research. It also defines what IRB should and should not do. But ultimately, the benefit must outweigh the risks, even if the research does not directly benefit the subject. It also ensures proper selection of research subjects, data and safety monitoring, et cetera. So you're probably all very familiar with this. I'm going to move into competency and capacity. So I think that one of the primary clinical ethical issues is dealing with patients that you have questions over whether they can actually consent. So competency is often used synonymously with decision-making capacity, and they're different things. Competency is a fairly low bar, and it's legal status for emancipated adults. It doesn't change over short periods of time, and it's, you know, so for example, if you are a mentally disabled individual, that's not going to change. Your competency is likely not going to change. If you are a child, it's not going to change for a long time until you reach the age of consent. If you are, you could be a competent person but lack capacity due to a number of barriers. And that can change over short periods of time. You may not be able to make a decision shortly after you get a morphine injection, but if you come back a few hours later, you may be more lucid. So these are some of the issues. And I can spend a very long time talking about capacity and competency. The main point is that many competent patients lack capacity, and some incompetent patients actually have the capacity to assent or consent. And think about a 16-year-old teenager. You can think about a mildly developmentally delayed or mildly intellectually, you know, impaired adult who may have a court-appointed guardian, but certainly could tell you things about preferences and that sort of thing. So in determining capacity, we use what's known as the UR criteria: understanding, appreciation, rationality, and evidence of a choice or expression of a choice. So these are sort of, you know, you can have understanding with no appreciation. This is sort of the typical, this is from an actual case, a woman with a weeping facial tumor who did not seek medical treatment for a long time, where the tumor was actually invading into the skull. I sat in on a session, and they explained to her everything that was wrong, and after the session asked if she had any questions, and she said, "I don't understand. Isn't there a cream you can give me for this?" So that was when the entire right side of her face had been replaced by tumor. So, you know, clearly this is a woman that is not able to make decisions for herself. We needed to invoke a surrogate decision maker. Rationality, you may have a patient who can explain and sort of, you can do a teach back and they seem to understand what they, you know, the diagnosis and the treatment. They seem to have some appreciation, but they don't want any treatment. And when you ask them, they give you some answer that seems consistent with an act of delusion. Like, you know, I don't want to be treated because I know you're trying to poison me, that sort of thing. Expression of a choice. Patients may meet all of the criteria, but may not be able to speak. They may be on a ventilator, have no facility to really communicate, and then we have to work hard for that. So there are various questions that test capacity, but the first two questions are really trying to get at whether they understand what you're saying. The third question, what will happen? You know, why do you want this treatment? Why do you not want it? Is trying to get at some appreciation. And when you're sort of asking, you know, what other choices do you think you have? This is all, sort of all teach back questions. When you ask patients if they have questions, what are they worried about, and they have nothing to say, it's often a sign that they're not really, they may not have truly understood what you said. A lot of people nod and indicate because they don't want to look stupid in front of their healthcare providers, and they may not actually have the understanding and appreciation you think they do. So who assesses capacity? Well, first of all, it's a medical determination that rests with the physician, the attending physician of record. And that attending physician may elect to, you know, have another consultant take, you know, take a look. The role of psychiatry is generally, it's usually not necessary, when you have a psych note that is telling you, yes, the patient is capacitated, what they're often saying is that they can't find any underlying mental health problems that are barriers to capacity. Because often after, you know, repeated psych evaluations, attending physicians may still have questions about this. Bioethicists can also help with capacity assessments, and we can determine whether the UR criteria is met. That's generally what we do, and then we sort of help you ask some questions, and sometimes we can, we often will attend, you know, patient meetings to, you know, explain things. So is there a standard for capacity? No. There's no single standard for decision-making capacity. There are sort of thresholds. Generally, the more serious the expected harm, you know, the more serious the condition, the higher the standard of capacity. So I often say, are we talking about a vitamin pill or surgery? You know, you would want a very high standard for patients to consent to a surgery or chemotherapy, you know, those kinds of things. You may need a far lower bar that is acceptable for lesser consequential treatments or therapies, like, you know, doing a diagnostic test or that sort of thing. So to sum up the informed consent issues, there's really three areas where we need to be worried about disclosure issues, where we're disclosing risks and benefits, material risks, reasonable person standard. We have to ensure that there is decision-making capacity and competency, and obviously there should be voluntariness, no coercion. So let's assume that we've gone through this exercise, and generally you don't really, it's difficult to assess capacity until you've gone through everything with the patient and done the teach back and then sort of assess that, gee, I think we need to bring in a surrogate decision maker here. So let's sort of turn to advanced directives and surrogacy. So first of all, when we're looking at beneficent care for the incapacitated, so in the case, in this case, we would really, autonomy is disabled and beneficence is enabled. And we're really looking at protecting patients from harmful decisions or preserving, if they've made out an advance directive, preserving some of their earlier preferences. In the story of surrogacy and advance directives, there's three seminal cases. The Quinlan case, so Karen Ann Quinlan was... had an anoxic brain injury after she had mixed some alcohol with some pills, and she was a young woman, probably about 21 or 22, and she ultimately wound up in a persistent vegetative state. This was a situation in which the parents asked to withdraw life-saving treatment or life support. And there was a tension because initially the hospitals refused to do it. This was not done at this point in time. And so this case not only established the rights of patients to sort of for their own self-determination, but it also established the fact that a surrogate can actually make a substituted judgment and can actually make these requests. The Nancy Cruzan case in 1990, so it was also a case about, it was also a situation in which the courts recognized the right of a competent person to refuse life-sustaining therapy. This was the first case in which artificial nutrition and hydration were considered a life-sustaining therapy. But the issue with this case is that the parents were able to present a case where they had evidence of what her patient's wishes would be. So again, it was a substitute decision-making case. But this was also a case in which it was clear that there needed to be more attention paid to advanced directives. Cruzan was in a terrible car accident. That's how she wound up in a persistent vegetative state. The Terry Schiavo case in 1990, she actually was in a PVS from 1990 to 2005, was really a clarion call about making sure that people have an advance directive, A, and B, making sure that the advance directive names a surrogate. So this was a case that was really not about life-sustaining therapy at all. It didn't make any changes that to that, but it was really a case where there was a tension between the surrogate decision makers. The husband was named the legal surrogate, and the parents were of the belief that they should be the surrogate decision makers. So surrogate decisions, ultimately, the best framework is if we know what a patient's preference is, and that would be established by an advance directive, if we had it, or a conversation with the patient, we're presuming. And so if you document, if you have a conversation with a patient, and they give you all kinds of verbal indications of what they want, if you document it in the chart, that would serve as indication, valid indication of a patient's preference. It doesn't necessarily have to be a formal advance directive that's filled out, although that would be certainly be a preference. If you don't know what their preferences are, we deal with substituted judgment, which really means someone who knows the patient, who can kind of tell you what their values might be, what they might have wanted in the situation. And if you, we often don't know any of that. So then you're left with nothing else but the best interest judgment, which is sort of the third best. Federal and state law with respect to advance directives, we have the Patient Self-Determination Act that came out in 1990. I think, is the middle of my pointer? Is that my, let's see what happens. When I press this, is it okay? The top one? Okay. Well, here we are. Okay, so this was, the Patient Self-Determination Act was actually a direct response to the Cruzan case. That obligates healthcare providers in institutions to provide written information to patients about advance directives. So that's one of the reasons why in the UK, you know, one of the, they come in, all of the patient information forms say, do you have an advance directive? The Kentucky Living Will Directive Act was actually passed in 1994, which instructs in four areas. So surrogacy designation, refusal or request of life-prolonging treatment. You can direct what you want to do about artificial nutrition, intubation, and wishes about organ donation. But the only thing that really counts is surrogacy designation, really. The biggest problems we have is not really being able to fully determine who the surrogate ought to be. So that we like to talk about advanced care planning as sort of the ideal framework. And these are where we actually start having these discussions with patients. And so there are several types of patients that should be targeted. So if you have a patient that doesn't have any family you don't think that, you know, or they don't have any family members who you think are capacitated themselves, you need to have these conversations. Patients for whom there is likely to be a disagreement among potential surrogates. You know, we have a lot of complicated families in Kentucky, so those are some of the other issues. Patients for whom the likely surrogate would make different decisions. So, you know, you have, we certainly have patients who have expressed one thing, family comes in and wants to rescind an advance directive or wants to say something, and because we have the patient's written wishes, we can advocate for the patient. And just recently, medical orders for scope of treatment, known as MOST, was actually passed in the Kentucky legislature. Some of you may know this as MOLST or POLST, which is either medical orders for life-sustaining treatment or physician orders. And these are specific orders that you can, it's sort of like a traveling order that follows the patient from hospital to hospital, so you don't have to keep revisiting this discussion and it's already, you know, written down. So if you look up, if you want to Google MOST comma, you know, Kentucky, you should be able to download the latest. I think it's still in a draft form, but you should be able to download that piece of legislation. So other issues that come up is sort of the whole notion of breaking bad news. And so this is a very cursory slide that is just introducing you to something known as the spikes model. Has anyone ever heard of this? Raise your hand if you have. Oh, okay, one person has heard of it. Okay, so this was actually invented by an oncologist, Robert Buckman. It's sometimes known as the Buckman model. And for those of you who are Monty Python fans, Robert Buckman is actually British. He used to pal around. He was actually very good friends with John Cleese, and they made several videos together about healthcare. But he was an early member of the troupe and then went on to become an oncologist. And he's very funny. He unfortunately is no longer with us, but he was a wonderful speaker. So the spikes model is sort of like a step-by-step guide to how to break bad news. And so the issue, you know, step one, set up the interview. Don't start having conversations, you know, walking into a room, you know, a shared room situation where there's somebody in the next bed and you don't really have the space to do it. So before you have this conversation, make sure that you arrange a private room or put curtains around the bed, involve the significant others or family members. As Dr. Buckman would say, before you tell, ask. That means that ask the patient, how would you like me to give you information? Do you want me to give it to you all at once? Do you want to know everything? Do you want to just know the, you know, so actually ask them about what kind of information delivery system works best for them. And a lot of patients will say, I just want to hear a little bit of this. Obtaining the patient's information. So again, how would you like to give me, how, you know, so this is sort of going into, you know, how would you like me to give you the information about the test results? That's a sort of a, you know, that kind of a question. For those of you who have watched or the book, The Emperor of All Maladies, there was a PBS documentary series that was based on this book. And it's sort of like the history of cancer. And then the last part, I believe it's actually only in three parts, so it's part three and not part four. That's a typo. But there is actually a wonderful presentation of a West Virginia young oncologist, and they actually show her demonstrating this model. They don't refer to it as the spikes model, but she does a very good job of breaking bad news. It's really important that in step four, you have to tell the patient that bad news is coming. Because you don't want to let them sit there and think that you're going to tell them something else. So you need to actually use the term bad news. And once you say, you know, I have some bad news to tell you, or I'm afraid I have bad news, as soon as they hear that phrase, mentally they begin to prepare. If you pussyfoot around too much and don't get to the point, patients can be even more shocked sort of at the end. So these are all, this is a piloted model that's been published, and there's a nice paper on it, and this was actually done in the early 1990s. So breaking bad news issues actually contribute to moral distress in the sense that if we don't have these conversations at the right time, if we have avoidance of these conversations, can actually also lead to moral distress. Moral distress is when the healthcare provider knows the ethical or moral course of action, but they're constrained from acting on it. The constraints can actually be caused by some of the patient's own preferences. Maybe patients are asking for aggressive therapy that is no longer appropriate. The constraints can be due to legal, policy-related issues, professional disagreement among the healthcare team. So, very often, what can happen is you can have an attending physician who is not comfortable having these bad news discussions, doesn't really have that kind of discussion with the patient. The patient is sort of laboring under misperceptions, and the nurses know what's going on, and it's driving them bananas because they don't feel that it's really their role to have this conversation. So these are some of the issues that can go on with moral distress. How many of you have ever seen the film Wit that was on HBO? Anybody know this? Okay, it's well demonstrated in that drama. So the triggers of moral distress, continued life support when it's not in the best interest, you know, again, inadequate communication about end of life with families, inappropriate use of healthcare resources. So all of these, the issue of false hope being given to patients and families, and often in the first bullet with continued life support, often that is that can be caused by families insisting on aggressive care when it's no longer appropriate. And this can, you know, so when we talk about pathological grieving, families that can't accept what's happening, they can't accept the news, they want to, as long as life is being prolonged, even though we really think it's a death that's being prolonged, the family feels better because then they don't have to face eventuality. So these are all part of communication issues that you deal with, I'm sure you deal with every single day. It's important to recognize that moral distress is not just about nursing. It was first recognized among nurses, and nurses have less moral agency often in their roles, which is why they may suffer from it more. But all healthcare providers deal with moral distress, and the link to the moraldistressproject.org, you can learn all about it. Organizational ethics solutions for this. So number one on the list is improving these death and dying dialogues with patients, improving or even training people to have breaking bad news sessions, the advanced care planning discussions. If your hospital does not have an ethics consult service that deals with this, you may want to consider setting one up. So some other issues I just want to sail through. When we talk about beneficence issues, we're talking about all the balancing of potential clinical harms that come with cancer treatment. I want to spend some time on some special problems with this. So these are all issues that we sort of struggle with in terms of cost-benefit analysis is really these issues. Therapeutic misconceptions. So there's special problems when sometimes the providers and patients have therapeutic misconceptions. Providers may come in with sort of rose-colored glasses and think that, you know, patients may actually be better candidates, and they actually are. You may have more inexperienced prescribers that are overly optimistic. Experienced prescribers may encounter enthusiastic patients, but the patients don't understand the risks associated with treatment, and you may have patients who just don't know what they're getting into. They may not understand that they're going to live an extended life that has poorer quality, and they often don't know what that means until they're there. Innovative therapy is another issue we struggle with in beneficence, and these would be novel procedures or treatment that offer greater benefit. Innovative therapy is what we would refer to as a non-validated practice. And if it's significant enough, it should actually become prospective research. We sometimes struggle, when is an innovative therapy? When should it become a clinical trial? And generally, it does not require IRB approval if there's no standard of care, whatever. The patient isn't a candidate for the standard of care, or the patient is refusing the standard of care. But if there is a standard of care, but you want to try something new and enroll the patient in something more novel, that is an innovative therapy. If you're collecting data and want to publish on data, that's when it rises to the level of a clinical trial. And finally, I want to talk a little bit about beneficence and justice. So these are distributive justice and economic burdens of treatment. So this is actually from a paper that I did last year with some colleagues where we were actually looking at the cost of tyrosine kinase inhibitors. And these are the average costs for the cancer that we were looking at, which are obviously fairly substantial. And these were the daily costs. We understand that in a lot of cases, these are given by the drug companies in clinical trials, so patients may not be paying these retail costs, but then what do you look, you know, when the trial ends, then you're looking at post-trial access. So this is a quote from, if you actually read the quote, you would think it was coming from a bioethics journal. It's actually from the journal Blood, and it was, the name of the article is The Price of Drugs for Chronic Myeloid Leukemia. And they were really, it was sort of a clarion call from a group of experts who felt that we were at the point where we were doing price gouging. And I'll just leave that on for a second so you can read it. But these are just, you know, really difficult questions that are being raised. Peter Singer, who's a bioethicist at Princeton, wrote an interesting piece in 2009 called Why We Must Ration Healthcare. And, you know, suppose the treatment cost $1 million. Would it be worth it then? 10 million? Is there a limit to how much you would want your insurer to pay for a drug that adds 6 months to someone's life? And so, you know, again, the issue with these drugs is that they, these are tumorostatic drugs rather than tumoricidal drugs. So, you know, they kind of can keep things at bay, but they can also have a lot of side effects. So there's a lot of issues. So in summary, when we look at what we mean when we say oncology ethics, I would say that it's actually a unique clinical ethics and research ethics context. So we're looking at a lot of things, screening and access issues, genetic counseling and disclosure issues. This is going to get more complicated with whole genome sequencing, for example. Psychosocial and cultural issues that we're still not very good at identifying in some cancers. The moral distress issues. Balancing treatments and benefits. And then I think we really struggle with truth-telling and breaking bad news, the clinical trial piece. So all of these issues are all part of the milieu of what I would call oncology ethics. Now, the Program for Bioethics at the University of Kentucky, we established RACE for Kentucky, which is an acronym I like, race as in horse race, and it stands for Regional Access to Clinical Ethics. And so we already have been very involved regionally with doing education and some outreach. So this is a more, we're going to be doing this in a more formalized way. If these are some services that you think you might be interested in, then we're just asking you to, you know, give me a call, we'll have a discussion, and every institution has a completely different culture and is completely different. So it's impossible for me to guess what services might be of use to you, but you know, usually some people may want some help with maybe training hospital ethics committee members. Some people may have no education going on at all and may, you know, would be interested in maybe, you know, a couple of lectures a year on some of these topics. So we have a booth outside. Please feel welcome to come by and talk to me, and then I'll coordinate with Sherry, and we'll see if we can bring this to you more regionally. I will end there. Thank you very much.